Hello and welcome to the 2014 MCLA National Championship broadcast in partnership with the Lacrosse Network. We're here in Irvine, California, the site of today's Division II first round matchup between the number 8 ranked Western Oregon University Wolves and the number 9 ranked Savannah College of the Art and Design Bees. I'm Chris Marshall, joined by Carlos Trejo, and we've got a pretty solid matchup today between these 8 and 9 teams. Just a reminder, this game, along with all of the 2014 MCLA first-round games, are being brought to you by Encore Brand. Action is character. Now, Carlos, who are a couple of these guys that we need to look out for on this Western Oregon team? They put up a lot of goals this season.
You know, they've got a few special players, Chris. Jacob Bohintz and Brandon Dedeman, both in the attack. Jacob primarily a goal scorer, and Brandon bounced across the board with 38 goals and 46 assists. So those are two players in particular to look out for. Also, Tyler Preston, number 6, listed as a faceoff specialist, but he's got 30 goals on the season. So he may be a guy that brings it straight down from the X.
Yeah, and he's got a pretty good record on the season, over 70% on the wins. He's 300 for 409, so definitely look for him to be making an impact on this game. And it's interesting to see these teams are pretty similarly matched in terms of the goals they allowed this season, but Western Oregon scoring over 300. Pretty crazy for a 16-game season.
It sure is.
You see the players taking the field here the very first game of this MCLA tournament in Irvine, California. Can't wait for the rest of the tournament. I know these teams are excited to be here. Had the opportunity to talk to both of these teams pregame and came up with some pretty interesting fun facts about some of these players, particularly with the SCAD players. Definitely some of these guys putting their degrees to good use right away, which is something you always like to see. Guys like Sean Horsey, he's a junior midfielder. Pretty excited, has a furniture show in New York coming up next week. So definitely excited to see these guys, what they're doing off the field. Just a reminder to all you guys that these are not only athletes, but student athletes. So it's always fun to see what they have going on off the field. And a reminder, this broadcast, like every broadcast we bring you, will be fully interactive. So please send us your tweets, comments, questions, anything you got to us at CMarshallTLN on Twitter. Again, that's CMarshallTLN. Now for the first face-off. Again, we've talked about Preston, and that one won by Western Oregon. And that's Post who's going to bring it up. Western Oregon, a team that only has 2 players on their roster from outside the state of Oregon. They're not wasting any time going for the shot right away,
that's
but no Bohintz problem.
That's on the shot.
No problem for Mantell. Bohint's one of those guys who is looking to shoot. And there's another shot right away by SCAD. And neither one of these teams wasting any time trying to test the goalies. And that's Ronnie Rothstein in the goal. It's Ruzala working from up top. Looks like he wants to dodge. Stood up by his man.
Good defense there in the midfield.
There's a nice move across. There's the shot, and that one just outside, but a pretty solid look from Singowitz. There's another shot. That one just over the top coming from Matt Dean. SCAD not shy about taking shots. Three already in the first minute. That's from outside, and that one's going to go in. Great shot coming across from Justin McInnes. And you see SCAD opting to be going more towards their individual matchups, kind of test the defense, see where their matchups are, and get some goals in the back of the net.
Also on that, Chris, you saw an attackman come up to the midfield and take that dodge against a close defenseman from the midfield. So we may look to see them invert throughout the game.
Preston wins that one to himself, and he's the third leading scorer on the team from the faceoff specialist positions. He takes that shot, and another big save coming for Mantell. Mantell moves it up. It's McInnes. Sorry, Horsey. And SCAD, definitely a team that has a pretty balanced attack when it comes to their scoring.
It looks like here in the first quarter they're going to run most of their offense out of your basic 1-3-2 set.
Trying to get inside. Oh. There's a nice check knocked out of his stick. It's like we're going to get a interference, or hold rather, going against SCAD, and the Wolves are going to get the ball back.
Nice clear.
Taylor Dugan. And Dugan, another one of the players to watch for this Wolves squad out of Western Oregon.
Repeating the B's goal, scored and assisted by good check. 16, Justin McInnes.
Stinger with it now up top. And you hear the defensive calls coming from the sideline. Coaches want the players to push out. Look to be in a little bit of a zone look here. There's a shot from outside. Again, eaten up by Mantell, who's playing well to start the game.
You know, Mantell's a lefty. It looks like they're not taking that into account when they shoot. They put their first two or three shots on his left side. They need to put that over on his off stick if they want to be successful against him.
There's a nice look across. Can't pick it up, but SCAD able to come back up with it. All the way across the field, a nice handle by Groff. Coming inside, there's the shot, and what a
save.
Ball still down. Looks like the ref's going to call it dead. Push going against SCAD. Again, just a one-goal game so far with the Bees, the number 9 seed, out in front. Definitely expecting this one to be one of the more competitive games we see here today. Bohintz takes it across. It's like an inadvertent whistle from official Biskowski. And Western Oregon going back into their offense.
1-4 set for Western Oregon, it looks like.
There's a nice look inside. There's the shot and the goal by Preston. And Preston, again, doing it all on the field today.
He is clearly more than just a face-off guy, no matter how they list him.
I mean, how important is having a reliable face-off guy?
Some coaches will tell you it's the most important thing to have, that possession is a key statistic in lacrosse, and if you can win the faceoff X, especially if you can dominate the faceoff X, odds are you're going to win the game.
We've got a couple of tweets coming in already. Looks like Charlie is watching the game on the big screen.
Good face.
So definitely exciting for to see that. And then Preston again with the faceoff win there, gets it back to Dugan. And with some of these D2 teams, you see a lot smaller roster, especially this Western Oregon roster, holding a just about 20 players, so everybody's got to be able to produce. I mean, you have some experience in that, you know, coaching some of the Chapman teams in the early 2000s that, you know, had 15, 16, 17 guys. I mean, how important is it to get some output from everybody on the roster?
It's critical, and, you know, in a tournament environment like this where it's hot out here, you're playing day in and day out, you're going to need to rely on some of those guys down in the bottom half of your bench that maybe you haven't played much this season to give you key minutes.
And there's a great finish inside by Taylor Dugan on the quick stick, and there's the skip pass going into the feed on the crease, and that's just a great cut across the middle of the field.
You know, the MCLA has done a great job with that point that you just mentioned. You know, 10 or 12 years ago when I was coaching at Chapman and before that at Stanford, they used to hold this tournament on four consecutive days, and if you didn't bring a loaded roster, it got hard to compete in those second couple of days. Now that they've spread it out across the week, it gives some of these smaller teams a chance to really compete for the title.
Yeah, and there are definitely some smaller teams. I know this Western Oregon team coming in at 15-1 on the season misses the ball there, but ball going to go back the other way. It looked like one of the attackmen stepped out of the restraining box. But some of the smaller teams like Concordia, who have some pretty talented players, but only suit up four or five guys on the sideline, definitely makes it a tall order. Malincek. Nice look again to Dugan. Dugan opts to pull it back out with the pole matchup.
I think for some of these smaller teams, the weather may play a factor today, too, in the time of your games. We've got some evening games, some day games. It should hit the mid-90s later this week. And if you don't have guys that are ready to run and well-conditioned at the end of your bench, you may run into some problems in the third and fourth quarters.
Detterman moves down low. It seems like they love to go back to that X look. See, as Dugan thinks about the shot, gets the immediate double. Back to Detterman. And SCAD doing a pretty good job of clogging the inside. There's a great look inside to Preston. Preston hits his own man with the shot. Looks like we're going to get our first penalty of the game. It's going to be a push with possession going against SCAD. This will be our first opportunity to get a look at the man-up unit for the Wolves. It looked like there was a lot of contact there on the crease. Probably a call that could have gone either way.
I think it's tight in there these days between a push and a player stepping into the crease. It's hard on an official to make that call.
And there's lots of room coming on the inside. Low angle shot. And that's another big save for Mantell. He's got a man right over the top on a rope. What a pass. Riley Mate's going to bring it across. And they've got some space going towards the goal. That's Travis. Wisely pulls it back out as they're still down a man.
SCAD needs to get a good possession here. The Western Oregon's had it at their end for a long time. Sometimes these defensemen need the attack to just give them a little bit of a rest and give them a chance to catch their breath and settle in. So this may be more important that it's a long possession, that they score quickly.
So McGinnis holding on to it, now back to full strength after that 30-second penalty kill. Looks like the Wolves opting to stay a little tighter in their defense. Both teams looking into zone looks, which I think is probably the way to go with these smaller teams.
Agreed.
I know we saw in the SLC tournament earlier this week, Santa Barbara go into a matchup zone that really gave Arizona State a lot of trouble. So definitely some opportunities for some teams that you know, don't have the same kind of pedigree as some of these other squads to go out there and give themselves an opportunity to win. There's McGinnis again holding it. Looks like he has the matchup with Dugan, trying to make it work. Great shot coming around the corner. No problem on the save there. And that's Rothstein in the cage for the Wolves. It's Hawkspear trying to fight through the double, gets by. And Bohintz into the box. And there's a shot off the corner. Great turn right over the head of Mantell. And Bonais does it all himself on that goal. And that pushes the lead to 2-1 in favor of the Wolves.
You know, the defender there made a good push at the goal line extended, and then he kind of gave up the goal with his with a one-handed wrap check that allowed him to come back topside and finish that off. He's got to stay with him defensively and not give the other team's leading scorer an easy chance like that.
Absolutely. And there's Henry, wins it to himself. looking for some space. Again, SCAD now behind for the first time in the game, 2-1. And Bohint's definitely one of those guys who likes to shoot. And pretty windy here today, actually out at the fields in Irvine, getting those Santa Ana winds blowing through with the heat. Now Horsey looking to dodge, has the shorty, quick double. Goes for the wrap chap again, and there's a nice look inside, that one just off the mark, but a solid shot coming from Brennan. Back up top to Henry, and Henry loses the handle, nice poke check. Horsey again has the shorty matchup. He's back into his left hand, calling for them to move it. Comes around the corner. Not a whole lot of room, so the lanes are clogged. Tries to force that one in there, gets it, gets the shot off, but definitely being harassed on the defensive side of the ball there. The B's going to bring it in from X. And SCAD in those black uniforms here in the heat. See if that plays any kind of factor here towards the end of this game.
If they're from down in Savannah, I think they're used to the hot weather, and maybe we've got a little bit less humidity than they've played in the past, so they may be one of the few teams that are okay out here in the hot weather.
Sankiewicz loses the handle after a great check coming across from Griffin Castor. Ball still down, somehow manages to get that one. Horsey, trying to find his man, throws that one right in between two guys, then there's a flag down on the field. We'll have to wait to see what the call is. Looks like SCAD's going to keep possession.
Let's see if they can put something together in this first man up opportunity. Momentum has swung a little bit towards Western Oregon. They need to get it back.
It's like an interference, 30-second technical going against number 9 for the Wolves, Hawkspear. And this is an opportunity for Savannah to tie this game back up. Rosala bringing it in. Had a lot of success going through Dean at X. Nice look inside. There's the shot. A big save. Rothstein looking very strong so far in this first quarter. So Dean's going to bring it in. Find Sankiewicz. Last 5 seconds on the penalty here. Rosala looking to shoot another good poke check. And they're back to even strength.
That was a good kill by Western Oregon.
Horsey seems to be the go-to dodger so far. Again, getting a lot of wind up here. So far, there's the shot, and that one just offside. Probably could have taken a step towards the goal before letting that one fly, Sankiewicz.
Yeah, correct, and you know, I think SCAD, maybe 75% of their shots at this point have been off cage. They've got to make that goalie make a save.
Sankiewicz going to bring the ball in. And doing a good job of finding their matchups and dodging against the shorties.
Good defense.
Horsey looking for some space, coming around the corner. Man loses his footing, switches hands. Nice little flip pass. Looks like there's some room across. And there's a great check on the backside. Now moving the ball up quickly. Oregon very dangerous in these unsettled situations. Detterman gets it down low. And then you can see Malincek calling for the team to slow it down a little bit. Been playing a lot of defense the last couple minutes.
Exactly what we were discussing earlier. He's aware. He's a smart attackman. He knows those guys in gray down at the other end could use a rest.
That's what you get out of your seniors, too. It's important to have guys with leadership like that to be able to control the game. And there's a look all the way up top. There's a great dodge and another goal. And that one coming from Taylor Dugan, his second of the game. And that pushes the lead to 2 at 3-1. It looks like SCAD wants to talk it over.
You know, I think SCAD, their defenders have got to stick with their matchups and use their feet. A little bit less with the stick, a little bit less trying to jump the ball, and keeping their body in front.
And again, correction score 4-1 in favor of the Wolves of Western Oregon. And again, just a reminder, these broadcasts, like all the broadcasts we'll be bringing you this whole week, are fully interactive, so definitely make sure to send us your comments, questions, anything you got to us at CMarshallTLN. Again, that's at CMarshallTLN. And, you know, while we have you, Carlos, why don't you give us a little background on your playing and coaching experience?
Chris, I started, like a lot of these players from non-traditional territories, not playing lacrosse until I was 14 or 15. I was fortunate enough to have a great high school coach in Jim Wilson at the Loomis Chaffee School. From there, I found my way to West Point, where I was fortunate enough to play on the Army team for 4 years. Served in the Army, and then as soon as I found my way out here to the West Coast, I tried to find some opportunities to coach, and that's when I found the MCLA. I was in law school at Stanford and coached that team for 3 years. Needless to say, my law professors were none the wiser. And then I came down here to Orange County, where I practiced law. And again, the love of the game got me out to Chapman University, where I was fortunate enough to meet you and the rest of those great players out of Chapman.
Definitely definitely a fun time in my life as well. I know, Carlos, my first coach, my first lacrosse coach. So definitely exciting to have you out here again in Orange County and taking in some wonderful lacrosse action.
Thanks. You know, Chris, and I think that's what makes lacrosse so great, is that guys like you and me, you know, whether it be high school or whether it be college, find this game and find a love for the game no matter when it is. And now you and I both have found, you know, our careers and our lives intertwined with this sport that we found comparatively late to some of the other great players.
Yeah, I mean, how important is it to the sport of lacrosse to have an event like this on the West Coast?
I think it's fantastic. I think it's great that you know, people are bringing the sport out this way. I think it's a great fit for kids out west. You know, lacrosse is a sport traditionally played in colder weather climates, and to have it have more and more teams in warm weather climates where lacrosse is really suited pick up the sport is great to see.
And there's a great man ball play as McGinnis able to come out there with the ground ball. And it seems like Preston is having a success winning the faceoff, and his wings are letting him down a little bit.
Agreed. I think they've got to do a better job over there. He's going to have to start winning them to himself.
And definitely someone with his scoring ability makes him a dangerous player if he can win those to himself. I know that's something we've seen out of the reigning MCLA Player of the Month, Encore Brand Player of the Month, Zach Handy, in recent weeks, being able to win that to himself. And that one almost sneaks in, but forcing the ball in on the crease into traffic, and the ball goes back to the Wolves holding on to that 3-goal lead. And SCAD definitely does not want to get in a shootout with these guys.
No.
We got our first tweet coming in. This one coming in from Michael Brand, actually the head coach out of Texas State, tuning in from San Antonio. So definitely thanks for tuning in. And everybody else, keep your tweets coming. Love to hear where you're watching from, how you're watching, and what do you think of the game so far, who you think is going to win, and you know, if there's anybody special that you're watching in these games. There's Hawkspear.
It's good defense and a great check there by four.
And you see the ball goes down, and it looks like there's Malinsek able to stay enough away from being on top of the ball to avoid the call there. And that was one fortunate not to get a slash there, coming right across the body. Dugan moves it across. It's Detterman. Nice roll back. And then a quick double. Fighting through. I don't know how he managed to get through 4 or 5 black shirts. That one's down.
That's gonna draw a flag. That you practically climbed on top of him. You know, these SCAD defenders have to stick with the body. I also think SCAD, and I know it's early in the game, maybe making a little bit of a mistake with larger numbers on their sideline by playing so settled in and giving the Wolves' attack a chance to rest and regroup at that end of the field. If I were coaching this team, and, you know, of course I'm not, but if I were, I might be out there, you know, asking them to press out knowing that Western Oregon's got limited reserves.
Yeah, I definitely agree with you there. At least pressuring the adjacents for sure. It'd be interesting to see, you know, how much trust that they'd have in their individual players in terms of their matchups. And that one going all the way across, that looked like it was probably the right look. He just couldn't get a stick on it. And still man down for another 15 or so seconds. He gets it to Mantell. 10 more seconds on the penalty here. And SCAD looks content to just try and hold this one down. You see Horsey in the middle. And that one looked like it was going to him, but picked off by Horef. And gets it across. They're going to have to get it into the restraining box. Probably got about 10 seconds left as they get it to Dean. And Dean able to get it in. And he's got some space. Looks like he's going to take it himself. Takes the shot. And again, another one off the cage. There's Threlkeld into the game, making his first appearance. Now Travis with it. Pretty consistently going to Horsey up top and sticking with that shorty matchup. Again, SCAD, the team that's been playing a lot of defense in this last one. There's Horsey with the bounce shot and another solid save coming from Rothstein. Rothstein been pretty solid so far in the cage, very fundamental in his movements. It's about 30 seconds to go in the quarter. They're moving the ball up, putting a little bit more pressure on the ride. And that one off his heel, it's going to stay in. And that one goose to his own man. Ooh. That's a great play to get it to Bohintz. Looks like about 10 seconds to go. Failure to advance. Because there's 10 seconds left in the quarter. SCAD has to get the ball up the field quickly and try and get a shot here.
They've got open men.
Can't come up with the ball, and that's a tough break for SCAD as this is how the quarter is going to end. 4-1 in favor of Western Oregon. I mean, what are you seeing out there from Western Oregon that's making them be able to put the pieces together?
I think they've got attackmen, as you said, who are seniors. They've got some veteran leadership, and they're looking for other players. I think SCAD came out in this zone, but when you're in zone, it's critical that you guard cutters and that you watch players inside, and I feel like they've given up some opportunities in that zone inside. And that's something that, you know, you do give up sometimes when you're not playing man-to-man, but they've got to watch those cutters and watch those inside players. I think, again, offensively and defensively, too, for SCAD, they're pretty stagnant. You know, again, I don't want to place too much emphasis on it, but I'd try and run these Western Oregon players a little bit. And what you see on offense with SCAD is one player doing all the work and five guys standing around, and that lets those defenders, particularly those midfielders, just rest at the defensive end. I think they've got to push those kids and make them tired. They've only got one or two lines of midfield.
Yeah, I mean, and you can definitely see the difference in the roster size just in these groups that they've got right now. Taking a look at the sideline for Western Oregon, I mean, there just aren't a whole lot of guys down there. So definitely a premium as you see them kind of throwing the water around, trying to keep themselves cool. I think all the way up to about 80 already here, and it's still before noon. So definitely something to look out for. Got a couple of more. More tweets coming in. This one from Alex Uchart. Don't know how good Western Oregon's D is. SCAD really needs to hit the net. And then tagging in Lacrosse We Trust. And that's definitely a point that we were making earlier in the broadcast is SCAD seems to have a pretty similar number of shots, if not more than Western Oregon, but they can't get good shots either because they're getting good lifts on the defensive side or just missing the cage completely.
Exactly. I think you've got to make a goaltender make saves. You can't do all his work for him.
And got another tweet coming in. And I mean, not to take anything away from the way that Rothstein is playing, he's been making the saves he needs to make, but definitely making it easy on him.
Exactly. I mean, it's not his fault that they won't give him an opportunity to make the save. But, you know, I think if SCAD could test him a little bit more, I think they'd be in better shape.
And then here's another tweet coming in from Scott McVicker, watching from Charlotte, North Carolina, rooting for all the SELC teams. Got to prove we can play with the best. And SCAD, definitely one of those teams who is a perennial tournament team, making their fifth appearance, obviously in the tournament last year as well. The farthest they've ever made it is the quarterfinals. So they've gotten out of the first round, but haven't been able to progress further than that. But coming off a pretty solid season, they definitely are putting themselves in an opportunity to do well if they can get past this Western Oregon team. You see Preston trying to pull that one out to himself, does so, and snatches it right out of the air, and that's a great play by Preston.
Yeah, that's a great effort doing it all himself.
And I mean, it seems like that's really what he's got to do. Not getting as much help as I think he'd like from the wings, but still impressive what he's been able to do. There's Malinsek. Covered to Detterman.
SCAD going to man-to-man now. I think they decided that that zone was causing him some problems.
Coming around the corner, nice look across the crease. That one just too tall for Malinsek, but all alone on the doorstep. There's Horuff going to bring this one in. Back to Mantell. And doing a good job of getting their shorties back as Ruzella able to pick that ball up from Mantell. And there's a nice look inside. Forced that one. Had a lane, but have been playing only defense here in this second quarter. Might have been a better opportunity for them to take a little bit of the time off the clock, get some of this momentum away from Western Oregon. Hawkspear doing well to bring it across. Keeps that one in a stick. Loses the handle. That's a great wrap check coming through. And there's a nice swim coming through the middle. Loses his footing. And then that one going back as Mantell out of his cage to back up the shot.
Great hustle by Mantell to get to that one and get his team possession back. Looks like we've got a guy hurt on the field.
He takes his gloves off. Hopefully that's going to be something that he's going to be able to come back from, but it looks like he might be grabbing his knee there. So hopefully he'll be able to okay. As you see the trainer come out and take a look at him.
It's tough to tell. I think he might have caught a check on the shin. I could be wrong about that, but I think he was involved in that play with the ball carrier, with the clearing man.
This got another one coming in from Scott McVicker. SCAD's D-man need to remember feet first, then hands. Trying too much against a high caliber attackman. Hashtag keep running. And I definitely think we've seen some of that. I know on the first goal of the game, we saw the defenseman overcommit on that wrap check and then and lose his man coming across the middle. And so definitely something that they're going to have to look out for.
Yeah, I think that tweet was right on the money. I think that it's not even so much the on-ball defender as it is the help defender. A couple of times I've seen the help defender come over and just kind of swing the gate at him rather than come in and put a body as the help guy. So if you're gonna slide and go, you got to get there and you got to put your body on. If all you're going to do is show, then the on-ball defender needs to know that and continue to play him straight up.
Yeah, and that was the freshman midfielder, Evan Ruzala, who's walking off under his own power. So definitely good to see that out of Simsbury, Connecticut. And looks like the ball is going to start with SCAD as they're bringing the ball up. Horuff taking it up. A lot of space to work with. Has Dean wide open in the middle, and Dean able to take it across. And I think it's probably a wise move from Western Oregon not to pressure too hard on the ride, given their numbers.
I think that's exactly what they're doing.
Threlkeld. Again, you see Dean working up top. Has definitely been making some plays in that kind of invert set that we were talking about, where he is playing from X. And you see the ball coming out, and you can hear the sideline coming, and now they're going back into a man ball, and SCAD has an opportunity here, a little bit of an unsettled situation, trying to turn around the corner. There's McGinnis, and no call on the hold there, and McGinnis definitely disappointed, and no one there to back up the shot as the ball goes back to the Wolves.
I think that was definitely a hold on the goal line. He turned him around, and that affected the shot.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those things, too, where it almost looked like he was trying to turn his body to get that shot off, but from the angle where we are up high, it was clearly a hold, so definitely getting away with one there as Western Oregon.
It's rare that you'll hear me complaining about giving a defenseman the benefit of the doubt, but I think in that case he probably could have gone to the box for just a 30-second hold.
There's Dugan holding on to it, senior midfielder out of Salem. Again, Western Oregon in Monmouth, Oregon. It's just a little west of Salem. Almost got a stick on that one as Lieber trying to make something happen for the Bees. Western Oregon doing a really good job of slowing the game down and letting the matchups come to them. It's like Dugan wants to go. Solid defense by Dean on Hawkspear. Hawkspear, a pretty big kid, as he moves that one behind. It's a nice handle. Got his defenseman hung up. Again, we see him overcommitting, and you can hear the sideline calling for the defenseman to play the body. He's throwing some pretty solid checks. He's made decent contact. That's Riley Mann, the senior defenseman out of Kennesaw, Georgia, but definitely freeing some space up for his attackman to get by. Mountsett comes around the corner. Mantell with a good save. You have to think that maybe he could have taken another step around the corner and thrown a fake.
That's a hold again, and they got him for that one.
And then you see the look like a premature stop there. So there you have it. It's going to be a hold going against the Wolves. So it's the call they missed earlier. SCAD going to keep the ball. Ball stopped on that play. He still had possession. Normally that's something you can play on, but the ward going against SCAD prevented them from advancing. So we're going to get another 30-second penalty going against Western Oregon. Neither one of these teams able to score in a man-up situation so far today.
No, this will be important for SCAD. Let's see if they can get a shot on Rothstein in this man-up.
And there's Dean, moves it up top, can't find his man. I mean, a little bit of a sidearm pass there, something you don't like to see if you're the coach.
One more.
Dean's all alone down there. See, McGinnis couldn't find him. It's him too late. And all the way back up top to Horsey. Last 5 seconds here on the penalty. Still unable to get a shot off. As they look at across the crease, takes the shot, another big save by Rothstein. I mean, he stepped right to the right spot. I mean, that's exactly what you want out of your goalies there.
He's playing confident today. He feels good. You can see it in the way he walks. You can see it the way he commands his clear. It's good to see a goalie with that kind of confidence this early in a tournament.
Yeah, and you see, even in the passing, it's just right on a rope finding his man. He knows where he wants to put it and then puts it right on him.
You can see him almost strutting back to the cage. He's feeling good right now, and that's how you want your goalie to feel.
Yeah, and we've got on good authority, talked to a couple of the kids before the game, that he is the worst player at FIFA on the team. So that's something that they thought was important for me to know as they go back into their offense. Detterman has a matchup here with the shorty all alone, takes the shot. I think he was looking for the slide to come across there. But a guy that we've seen more in a facility – as a facilitator than a dodger, but in the few opportunities he's had, seemed to have been able to create some free space for himself. It's Malinsek. Hawksbear trying to get some move, and there's a great hitch move. Comes around the corner, and a big save by Mantell as that one went off his stick and then off the pipe. But we see this Western Oregon team trying to take as much time off the clock as they can. Seems like a pretty wise move. Have a three-goal lead. SCAD doesn't seem to be able to get anything going offensively. And with the numbers they have on the sideline, only six guys suited up and ready to come in. They're going to need all the help they can get in terms of keeping their energy up. Mantell gets it back from Ruzella, who's back in the game. So nice to see that he's back and playing. Horsey going to do it all himself on the clear. Horsey looks like he has a little bit of a lane there, wants to go to his right, draws the double, and some space down the middle as he goes in, takes the shot.
Great save.
And Rothstein again with the big save. I mean, he's a brick wall back there right now.
And they've got to change it up a little bit. They've got to do something else. He's seeing everything that they're doing.
Nice move across, and he loses the handle, but is able to...
Offsides, it looks like, Chris.
Offsides. There you have it. Thanks, Carlos. As they move the ball up in another unsettled situation. You'd like to see them maybe try and get a quick shot in here, see if they can break the seal.
And if you notice here at this end, again, you're gonna see SCAD giving the Western Oregon defenders a chance to just stand still. You know, SCAD's got to, you know, even just to rotate their attackmen and get those defensemen's feet moving. It's really tough to play this kind of one-on-one lacrosse.
And they're going to get a push there. To be a little dramatic on the on the dive there, but we are in Southern California. Either way, it's going to be a timeout for Western Oregon as they want to make sure they get their defense set up and continue their success going against this SCAD team.
And I think it'll be important how that Western Oregon coach uses his timeouts to give this group a rest. You can see the Western Oregon defenders walking off the field. Rothstein, of course, jogging over to the sidelines. He's got plenty of steam, but the rest of them may need a little blow.
I mean, how important is it to build off the energy that your goalie has when he's on a streak like he is now?
There's nothing better as a defender to know you have that guy behind you, you know, both in the way he talks and calling out to you and the way you play defense. You know, if you've got a great goaltender behind you, and I've been fortunate enough to play in front of a few, you know, you can make a mistake here and there, and you know you may not have to push out as hard and, you know, give up a, you know, 15, 16, 17, 18-yard shot, knowing that that goalie behind you is going to pick you up and get the ball back out and get you on offense. So it's a huge advantage emotionally and psychologically to have a good goaltender behind you.
Yeah, and definitely an opportunity to throw some checks you may not throw and get some of the junk out there for the cameras here, huh?
Yeah, it depends on who your coach is. Depends on who your coach is. Your goaltender may pick you up with that save, but your coach may bring you right over the sideline. So.
So we see the huddle over here, and a lot of it's like leadership coming from these defensive players as well, as you see them leading some of the meeting as they're over there trying to get their minds right before SCAD comes back out here for another offensive set. But very strong so far collectively, the defensive unit for Western Oregon. Again, this is the first game of the day for the MCLA Championship Tournament. In partnership with the Lacrosse Network, brought to you by Encore Brand. So definitely excited to be here and bringing you this lacrosse on a beautiful Southern California day here on the campus of the University of California at Irvine.
SCAD really, I think, has got to break the seal here. They've got to find a way to get back on the board and give themselves a little lift and try and get Rothstein to, you know, maybe second-guess himself a little bit, because right now he's seeing the ball like it's a beach ball.
Yeah, and it's been, you know, 20, 25 minutes since SCAD's been able to get on the board. They scored the first goal of the game, and Western Oregon on a four-goal run right now. So definitely some momentum in their corner. And moving the ball pretty well in this offensive set as they go up to Henry. Henry wants to dodge. He's by his man. Quick double.
That's a good slide there. That's what we need to see more of from the SCAD defenders, a good slide with the body.
But doing well to move the ball. Is that one's McGinnis trying to find some space, finds Dean. Dean all alone, can't get the handle. There's a nice check coming from behind. Again, good man ball play from the Bees. Threlkeld moves it back up top to Dean. Dean's been pretty crafty. Takes the shot and buries it up top and drops his shoulder just a little bit to get Rothstein going down and pins it right over his helmet. That's a great finish by Dean.
That was well done by him. That's exactly what his team needed. He's fired up.
I mean, as he should be. Again, the first time the Bees have been able to get on the board, as you see the fans on the far side flapping their bee wings, but definitely getting fired up. Both these teams bringing some fans to the game. It's always exciting to see when teams travel well, especially down here. I mean, everybody wants to come to Southern California this time of year.
It is, you know, and even though this team is from the Savannah, you know, a lot of these players are from all over the place, the Midwest, the West Coast, and, of course, the East Coast, so. They enjoy the opportunity to come see their kids play.
Well, and especially here, there's a late hit. Fortunate not to get a flag there, and there you see it coming from the near official, who had a real clear line of sight on that one as Horsey's able to get the ball into the box. But we're going to get another opportunity for a man up for SCAD. And definitely something to point out, you know, you see a school like Western Oregon that has a lot of local players, and we see that a lot with some of these teams. I know UNLV only had two guys for Division I. There's a nice swim coming across and buries the shot low to high. What a finish by Ruzala, and this is a ball game once again at 3-4 in favor of Western Oregon.
And it looks like the flag's wiped out. I wasn't sure if it was a technical or a personal, but it looks like they're going to wipe that flag out. Had that been a personal, it would have been a real swing in momentum for SCAD.
Absolutely. So they may have just gotten him with the push with possession with the technical there. But, yeah, as I was saying, I mean, you get some of these teams that have a lot of local guys, and then just based on the type of school that, you know, Savannah School of Arts and Design is, they get kids from all over. And a lot of East Coast kids, I mean, there isn't any kind of rhyme or reason to where all these kids are coming from. And it's nice to see, you know, all these kids coming from these different communities and coming together as a team and doing something special here in Irvine.
And, you know, Chris, you're seeing that not only on these MCLA rosters, you know, where you've got some some less experienced kids, or, you know, and nothing to take away from these MCLA players, but perhaps not Division I players. You're also seeing that same kind of change.
What a finish inside by Tyler Preston. That might be the play of the game so far by the face-off specialist, quote, as he goes all Tim Desko with the no-look shot that just goes top shelf. That's a big momentum goal.
I mentioned that to you before the broadcast, Chris. A kid who's listed as a face-off specialist who's got that many points is perhaps being hidden by the coach on that roster. He is not just a face-off specialist.
And he's definitely been the player of the game so far for the Wolves, doing a really good job winning face-offs. Again, just over 70% on the season. Really impressive number for this team. And then no call from the sideline as the SCAD player just gets eaten up.
Great hustle by that attackman. That's exactly what you need out of a guy like that when the momentum's starting to shift the other way. Great move.
And you see Dugan with the ball now. Looking all the way across. That one almost picked off, and a lot of space here for Detterman to come inside. They've got numbers, opts to hold it and come across. That one was dangerously close to being a high hit.
Agreed. These SCAD guys have got to set their feet and play more body defense.
Nice little fake outside, trying to find someone inside, and again finds Preston. It looks like Preston might have stepped in the crease there, but Preston finding himself open on the crease more often than not. And this one going up for McGinnis.
And this is where I think you're going to start to see the advantage, Chris, is SCAD with a quick restart.
And what a finish. That one right over the shoulder. Didn't look like Rothstein ever saw it, as McGinnis able to get SCAD back on the board and cut the lead back to one.
That's exactly what we were talking about. That time, the goaltender for SCAD moved that ball out quickly, and Western Oregon found themselves substituting, trying to get fresh legs on the field. And that was the first time you saw Western Oregon maybe look a little tired, and SCAD really pushed the tempo and create, essentially, an unsettled opportunity off of a settled clear.
Yeah, and that's definitely something that SCAD's got to continue doing if they want to really take advantage of the fact that they've got, you know, another 15 guys on their sideline. And you can definitely see it coming up with the wing play as they're able to come away with another ground ball. That's Riley Mate.
And I think that's the first time we haven't seen six on the faceoff. I think he needs a rest, and that may take a toll too, because he's a heck of a faceoff guy.
Definitely, it's kind of one of those things when you have such a small team, you got to pick your poison, because he's playing so well on the offensive side of the field. He's got two goals already today. It's like, where are you going to be able to use his energy? It doesn't really matter how fit you are or how good of a player you are. It's tough for anybody to go out there and play 60 minutes of lacrosse.
Absolutely.
And not to mention that they're going to have to play tomorrow if they win. Drizala. And now SCAD looking like the team that's got a little hop in their step. As Rizala coming around the corner, he's by his defenseman, takes the shot, and that one off the mark, but it's going to stay with the Bees.
You know, to finish my point earlier, Chris, as I was saying, not only do these MCLA rosters have a ton of talent from all over the country, but our Division I rosters nowadays, the Virginias, the Syracuse, the North Carolina, have got players from the West Coast, the Midwest, the Southeast. Lacrosse is a national sport now, without question, and you're seeing that not just at this level, but at the big-time level.
Yeah, you see some of those guys, especially we had the opportunity to bring a game as SCAD coming around the corner. There's a nice check, knock that out of his stick, to bring the Notre Dame-Denver game from Orange County at Orange Coast College over. And then there's going to be a call going against the Wolves, and the Wolves have got to keep those calls down in numbers if they're going to want to stay in this game. They've been playing a lot of defense right now in this second quarter. But we had the opportunity to bring the Notre Dame-Denver game from Southern California's historic moment for California lacrosse, our first Division I game, regular season game. And you see the talent on display. There's a local product at a Foothill High School not far from here in Tustin, California, Amundsen, who had five goals that game. And it's exciting to see players from all across the country starting to get excited about the sport of lacrosse. There's a look inside. That one a little bit too ambitious, looking for Threlkeld. But, across the board, there's a lot of exciting lacrosse going on. There's a big hit coming across the middle. And that one going to go down. Threlkeld can't get it. Looks like he's going to be able to pick it up. But then a nice hustle play on the defensive side of the ball. But that one eaten up by Riley Mann as he rolls back and able to get the ball across, gets it to Horsey, and I think this is the guy they want with the ball on his stick as he gets it down low. But all levels of lacrosse right now, we've seen a lot of a parity across Division I as well, with Albany or Albany going in the Thompson brothers, playing very exciting brand of lacrosse this season and coming away with a victory against Loyola, as well as Bryant upsetting Syracuse. It's really anyone's game this season.
Repeating the Savannah College of Art and Design goal, scored unassisted.
You see them again trying to take a little bit of time off the clock, certainly looking more comfortable in their offense than we've seen them look earlier in the game.
As you mentioned earlier, you can see a little extra pep in their step from Savannah.
I see Horsey going in there, not shying away from the contact, as he again finds another one. Looks like Rothstein does well to come out of his cage and get that ball.
This is a critical clear for Western Oregon. They've got to get the ball down to their offense and take a little break here.
And there's a great look to Hawkspear. Hawkspear has a line, pulls it out.
There
as
it
you
is.
See, Malinick comes around the corner, buries the shot, fakes on fakes, and draws the penalty. And that's a big goal coming from the senior.
That was just what they needed.
It looks like the penalty is going to stand. It's going to be a high hit coming across late on Malinsek. I mean, you gotta hit him, give him something to think about, but an opportunity for Western Oregon to extend their lead from two here with this man-up situation. And you're the coach calling from the sideline from Western Oregon, no more goals. A lot of space on this side of the field. One of the newer rules instituted last season on the man-up face-offs or man-down face-offs, depending on what side of the ball you're on, you no longer get to bring an attackman up to run the wing. And you see one of the players already off camera, but losing his lunch on the sideline, really leaving it all out there. And, I mean, that's what you love to see if you're a coach. You got players who are out there just selling out for your squad, but got to make sure you stay hydrated as Hawkspear taking a break right now.
And, you know, you can talk to college kids all you want about nutrition and you know how to eat healthy, but you know they see that buffet bar, and those waffles start to look pretty good 2 hours before the game.
Yeah, I know, definitely. One of those guys notorious for you know eating cheeseburgers before games is you know MCLA great Chapman great Danny Metoyer.
No question about it.
You know, go out and score 100 points in a season with a bacon cheeseburger before every game. It's definitely. A wild card as Detterman looks up top. Malinsek takes the shot, and the worm burner goes in, and that's two straight goals for the senior, Malinsek, and the lead is now three.
Perhaps ignoring his coach's advice when he told him we didn't need it anymore, but then again, I don't see the coach complaining. That's always how that goes.
Yeah, and definitely, you know, a team, you know, over the course of the 16-game season scoring 350 goals. I mean, it's tough to tell these kids not to shoot.
No, and they're doing a great job.
And already seven goals here in the first half, on pace to score just about as many as they do all season. And that one won again by Preston, but snatched out of the air by McGinnis. McGinnis got some time and space now, thinks about taking the shot, and he does, and rips it top shelf. What a shot. It was a good step by Rothstein, as you see him hanging his head a little bit, maybe losing some of that swagger he had earlier in the game.
Maybe so, but the other thing he's losing is his midfield defense. There were two Wolves defense or defensive midfielders who didn't even make it into the box on that one. So they're jogging down the field. They're having a little bit of a tough time with that, but as you can see them with their hands over their head coming off the field. I heard the Western Oregon coach jokingly ask the table if there were IVs available for his players. I think he knows what we know. And again, I don't mean to place too much emphasis on it, but you know, we've all been on the field in these kind of conditions, and I know the people out there listening have played in hot conditions, and you know what it's like towards the end of that game.
And we're up at 91 degrees right now here in Irvine. You know, a little bit of a wind, and you get some of that breeze coming off the ocean, only about 8 miles from the beach, but it's still hot out there in full pads at 91 degrees.
No question about it.
We've got a couple of more tweets coming in. MJ Mitchell tweeting out, giving us the thumbs up emoticon, which is one of my favorites. It'll shoot you back some praise hands. And he's tuning in from Denver, so always exciting to hear that one. And Alex Uquart is giving us an update from the NBA. NDSU game, looking like a machine out there, and I believe that they are taking the field against Concordia, one of the local teams, which is another one of those teams we've seen have some trouble with numbers, but were able to go out in an impressive fashion, win the SLC tournament. So definitely exciting to see some of those teams from, you know, non-traditional hotbeds really play well. I know that North Dakota State has been, you know, kind of a perennial tournament team the last couple of years, and it's nice to see a program from North Dakota have some success.
Absolutely. I was speaking to one of their coaches last night. He was mentioning that they've got snow all around their field right now still. So for those teams to get out here in the nice weather, you can tell they appreciate it.
Yeah, I know we're missing one of our broadcaster for this first game due to the 2 feet in snow in Denver over this week. There's a Preston wins it to himself, and again, nobody there to help him. And he's looks pretty upset about that as SCAD gets the ball going back on their offensive side. Nice look inside, plenty of space, takes the shot, and Rothstein getting some of that swagger back as he's able to get that one and throws it all the way down to the end of the field. But that's going to do it here for the first half of action. And we've got a pretty exciting game so far. It's a two-goal lead for Western Oregon over SCAD. Don't go anywhere. Plenty more lacrosse action coming your way. And welcome back to the 2014 MCLA National Championship broadcast in partnership with the Lacrosse Network. We're here in Irvine, California, again for the second half of action between the number 8 Western Oregon Wolves and the number 9 Savannah College of the Arts and Design Bees. And we've had a pretty good game so far. The score 7-5 in favor of Western Oregon. But, you know, it's definitely going to be interesting to see what Western Oregon can put out there in the second half. It looks like they're already down one guy who's taking his pads off.
Yeah, you know, I think that the momentum in this game in this first half has swung back and forth with each team having the momentum for 5 or 6 minutes at a time. We'll see if one team can kind of grab a hold of it and sustain it for a few minutes or for a quarter.
And just a reminder, this game along with the rest of the 2014 MCLA first round games are being brought to you by the Encore brand. We're seeing Preston out there on the faceoff trying to continue winning those. And again, no push to go for the ball for Western Oregon. As you see, SCAD able to come away with the faceoff win once again.
And this is the worst thing when you're a coach to have a guy like that who's so valuable to your team at the faceoff X, because now he's got to go out there and play 4 or 5 minutes of defense, which is going to wear him out on the offense and for the next face. It's always a challenge. You don't want to lose somebody that valuable and who wins that many faceoffs, but as he gets worn down throughout this game and throughout this tournament, they may want to think about bringing in their second faceoff guy and using him for offense, because he's a pretty powerful offensive weapon.
And again, a reminder, this broadcast, like every broadcast here on the MCLA.us website, there's Dean Gems inside, gets the shot off. Ross Dean, a big save. We'll be fully interactive, so make sure to send us your tweets, comments, questions, anything you got to us at CMarshallTLN. We'll get to as many of them as we possibly can. But again, it's at CMarshallTLN. Love to hear where you're watching from, how you're watching, who you're watching, and you know, what you think of the game so far.
You know, I think I'm seeing a Rothstein back there making every save low. He's given up a few high. They may want to think about keeping those shots upstairs. He is very, very good down low, especially in tight.
And then there's Bohans coming around the corner, takes a shot, trying to do it himself. As Malincek going to bring it in. And Malincek's got some pretty good speed as he draws the double. He gets it all the way back across to Bohans. Bohans buries the shot right off the hip of Mantell, and it's a 3-goal lead for the Wolves. Malincek has really been doing a good job forcing the issue from X. He's one of those guys, definitely seems like a calming presence for this Western Oregon offense. Again, 8-5 in favor of the Wolves of Western Oregon.
You see Preston here on the face. He's been on the field since the quarter started, so if they don't get the ball this time, he's going to end up being on that field for a long, long time. See if they can take advantage of him at the offensive end here. If I were Savannah College of Art and Design, I'd find him in that defense, and I'd go right after him.
And we were noticing when we were seeing these guys come across as Horsey now has it up top and moving it around. And again, still staying in that zone. And Preston doing the right thing, staying top center in that zone. Definitely trying to force these guys down the alleys and away from Preston. Lots of space inside for McGinnis. McGinnis takes a shot, and that one off the pipe. And Horsey unable to come up with it. That one's going to go back on the offensive side of the field and almost picked up. And then finally, looks like Detterding is going to be able to get it, but he draws the push, and that's great body positioning from Detterman. But just a heads-up play. Detterman unable to pick up the ground ball, but making sure he is in front of his defenseman and drawing the push there. There's Stinger coming back into the game, getting some extra PT here, as we see Western Oregon still down a player. Coming around the corner, takes a shot, and that one just off the mark, takes a big hit. No call on that one as Dugan paying the price. As Doug Henry, the faceoff specialist, 6'1", 180, really cleans his clock there. Malincek doing well to get free. Nice look inside, can't find his man. That one picked up and takes the shot, and that one off the side. Low angle on that shot, but a possession shot coming from Preston. You have to think maybe Preston comes out on one of these offensive sets. Again, you mentioned he's been on the field this entire time for Western Oregon.
He's a valuable asset. I know if they don't score here, he's got to make sure he gets off the field in transition.
It's Bohintz comes in, takes that one right onto Mantell. It looks like he's trying to make his way off, and looks like he's going to be able to, as SCAD subbing two players as well. And that one just barely kept in by Savannah. That's Lieber, and Lieber loses the handle, and that ball down. But it looks like Lieber's going to be able to get it, and it's going to be a hold going against SCAD. And the Wolves going to be able to start with this one as Malincek gets it and moves the ball back up to Dugan.
And here comes Preston again.
Just coming on the sideline, getting a sip of water, getting back in that game. At least it looks like he'll be able to get himself off, especially starting at that top left position as the first person off. Giving him a lot of space there.
He looks exhausted.
I can't imagine he's not. He's been on the field for probably, 10 minutes of actual time. Dugan coming up top, working on Dean.
Great
Dean stands
defense.
Him right up and then loses his footing, overcommits. Dugan coming inside, moves the ball all the way across, can't quite find his man. Looked like he was looking for the shot first, and that ball picked up by McGinnis, and McGinnis has got some good speed, but caught right away as they go for that immediate pass, and he's got to move it quickly, gets it inside, and thinking of the shot before he gets it off is Sinkowitz, and he had a lot of time there all alone. As Preston's going to bring it across. He wishes he had that one back down three goals.
Yeah, that was a terrific opportunity for them. But again, you see SCAD in transition, and you see the Western Oregon players, especially the midfielders, kind of falling behind.
And there's Dugan getting inside, scoring the goal. It takes a pretty good hit, but very patient over there, able to score that goal after throwing a couple fakes.
I think, to be honest, the only player back in transition that one for Western Oregon was Bohintz. I think he left his attack spot and hustled back on defense to try and give those midfielders a break, and that may have helped save the goal at the other end.
And that's just what you're going to have to do with a team like this. You're going to have to recognize, what guys need to match feet and what guys can stay back on the offensive side of the field. It's like one of those things where you might want to think about getting Preston. See, Preston's so tired he doesn't even know what side of the field he's on. But giving Preston, as he wins that one to himself and sends it forward, maybe having one of the midfielders start in the attack side of the box, and then if given the opportunity, as that one just going outside, switch back so Preston will not have to go back on defense.
Agreed.
But again, send your tweets, comments, questions, anything you got to us at CMarshallTLN. Use the hashtag MCLA2014. And Malincek comes around the corner. Great look inside. Another great finish by Bohintz. And he is really looking sharp. And that pushes the lead to 10-5. And Western Oregon might be running away with this one. SCAD wants to talk it over. And it's head coach Michael Cummings bringing his guys in. And he's got to calm them down here a little bit as Western Oregon kind of starting to pull away with this one.
Yeah, I'm impressed with Malincek. He seems like he can do it all back there. He's got some really quick feet, I think, that's giving the SCAD defenders troubles. And he can both feed and go to the cold and get it himself.
Got a tweet coming in from Brandon Benedict, watching from Springfield, Oregon, and watching Michael Pearson of Western Oregon, hashtag Go Wolves. So definitely exciting to see the fans not only on the far side of the field, but also at home enjoying these games brought to you on MCLA.us in partnership with the Lacrosse Network. So definitely keep those coming. And you can see the coach down there, trying to fire his guys up, definitely letting them know where they've got the advantage. It's tough not to to try and at least get some of those matchups going their direction. Western Oregon just taking advantage, definitely looking like they're the ones with the bigger team.
No question about it. And I think SCAD's really got to push their opportunities when they've got them. I think they've got to move the ball down the field quickly in transition, take advantage of the substitutions by Western Oregon, and really get those guys moving. Western Oregon's got a good lead here, but I think if that lead's not going to be safe if they start to tire in the third and fourth. There's plenty of lacrosse left.
Yeah, still about halfway through this third quarter, and a lot of lacrosse to say or to play. A couple more of these guys, pretty impressive stuff from SCAD. I know that Riley Mate, senior LSM, actually out of Los Angeles, kind of a local product, accepted a job in design for Vineyard Vine. So I know
wow.
This guy's proud of their accomplishments on the field and as well as post-collegiately.
Chris, you may want to stay in touch with that guy.
Yeah, right.
When you get out of here, you're no stranger to those Vineyard Vine styles yourself.
It's definitely the case. And Preston wins it himself, and then nobody goes to the ball. but finally picked up by Riley Mate, who we were just talking about, as he gets the ground ball, and that's a big ground ball for SCAD. Finds Horsey, and Horsey with some time and room opts to pull it back out, and I mean, they've got to put some pressure on this Western Oregon defense. Henry back to Horsey. And Rosala. Rosala trying to get inside. Stood up by Detterman. It's Nate Travis. Who's the backup with the McGinnis. And against SCAD. Just slowing it down a little bit. It looks like they want to feed that that crease player and get the quick shot going. Coming around the corner, nice move to Rosella. Rosella buries that one top shelf again. That's the second time we've seen him go low to high on Rothstein.
That's a heck of a shot. And again, I think Rothstein, the place you want to put it is up top. I think he's too good down low. You know, you may have some space available high if that's where you want to go with the ball. Although, when you go low to high like that, you're going to fool a lot of goalies.
Absolutely. And especially we've seen a lot of the low to low goals, especially coming from Western Oregon. Malincek with a couple of those. So. You know, I mean, that's what you got to do when you're telling your team to shoot. You got to change the plane, whether it's a bounce shot or going low to high or high to low. Preston wins it to himself. So he's going forward.
He's going to have to do that, I think, for the majority of the time if he wants to continue to be successful.
And again, you see Malincek up there coming to help his boy out.
Assist on the goal. Credited to number 29, Nate Travis.
It looked like Nicholas Alexander wanted to stay on the field there with his pole.
Number 4, Evan Rosella.
Dugan back to Malincek. And Western Oregon doing a good job of taking some of the time off the clock as Dugan looking to dodge on Horsey. Gets by his man, takes the shot, takes one in the arm there, loses the handle, and picked right back up by Bonice. Bonice gets it inside, tries to get the shot off. Horsey right in there blocking that one with a stick. The ball's still down. Looks like it's going to be a push going against Western Oregon as Horsey gets in good body position there and is able to draw the foul.
Hey. Western Oregon doing a good job in transition this time. Not going to give up a fast break opportunity. And then we've got a flag down as well.
I think it's probably going to be a slash as Savannah's looked pretty sharp in that unsettled situation. Definitely been having more opportunities out of the unsettled than they have out of their offense even.
If they could get a goal here and then continue with the possession and continue with the man up, it could be just the opportunity they need to get back in the game.
Right, just down just four goals. I mean, lacrosse, a game of runs. We've seen teams come back from a lot more than that. And that one comes across the middle and another big save. But it looks like he may have stepped in the crease. McGinnis stepped on the crease before he gets out there. So we'll see what the call is here. It's like going to be a one-minute penalty as official Biskowski here with the call.
And again, had that shot been live, another great save inside down low by Rothstein. I would not put it down there.
There's Malincek with the slash, you know, trying to ride hard, keep some momentum in the corner of the gray shirts here, but drawing the penalty, and here's SCAD with an opportunity to get right back in this game, again, just down four goals.
You know, their last man up, they stayed in this 1-3-2 set without much motion.
There's Dean coming around the corner trying to make that happen. And there's a great defensive play by Colin O'Neill, able to trap that ball so Rothstein could pick it up.
See if they can get a good ride here and get it back.
But it's probably not what you want to see if you're the coach. On the first guy to touch the ball goes and tries to take advantage of an individual matchup. Looked like he had some space there. And that one, Mate unable to come up with it, but picked up by SCAD on the overthrow and back to Mantell. And Mantell all the way down the field. What a pass.
Wow.
On a rope. I mean, that must have been 60 or 70 yards all the way across the field. And there's the shot and another big save up top. And no possession on the man up for SCAD. You can't say that you're probably happy about that if you're on the sideline.
No, they're not valuing the ball.
And there's Grant Post with some space. Moves it to Alexander. And Alexander playing with a shorty. So one of those guys going both ways on offense and defense. I mean, that's what you need out of teams that are this small. Have guys who can play with a pole and a shorty. As they're back to even strength, holding that four-goal lead. Malincek trying to get by. That's great defense.
And Malincek from the midfield. That's not his usual spot, but now he's going to get back into his comfort zone.
Bohintz takes the shot. That one off the mark. Looks like it's going to stay as Preston able to back that one up, but just barely.
Western Oregon is certainly not content to just sit on a lead. They're going to keep going after it and keep trying to put up goals, but it sounds like that's their style all season long. So,
and there's Detterman coming inside, takes the shot. Mantell, popcorn, eats that one up. And then on a rope again. He passes as well as any goalie I've seen all season. Really does a great job as Dean out by his man, trying to run through two. Draws the flag there. It's probably going to be a hold. Ball still down, and a great opportunity for McGinnis as he almost buries that one right off the ground. But we're going to see another opportunity for SCAD and man up, and they really need to start scoring on these opportunities.
Yeah, and I think they've got to do something besides sit in that 1-3-2 and wait for somebody to magically come open. They've got to maybe get into a set. I don't know if this coach has some man-up plays he likes to run, but now might be a time.
And you got another tweet coming in from this one from Ike at EJ Icard, watching from Oregon, supporting number 8 freshman on that Western Oregon defense, and talking about Michael Pearson. So thanks for tuning in. Glad to hear you're watching the game.
We've got some big Michael Pearson fans out there.
Big Michael Pearson fans. So hot right now.
Number 1 selling jersey in the Western Oregon market.
That's no easy task. Send that one back across. Plenty of space here. Takes the shot. And another shot off the mark for SCAD. Again, they're doing a good job of creating opportunities, but unable to get those on the cage. Is that one over the top? Horsey looking to shoot before he got it in his stick. Ball still down. Defenseman loses his footing. But kicked out. Looks like Western Oregon will be able to pick that one up. But another penalty kill as that one comes across. Dean takes the shot just off the mark, trying to avoid the hit there.
Yeah, Dean's playing a great game so far, but he can't be the only guy looking to hit the back of the cage here.
Yeah, and it's his body positioning that really is kind of setting him apart. As you see him, it's just his movement with his stick. You can tell he's a confident player. And then there's the wrap check as that one goes out of bounds. And you see at 34 for Western Oregon, it's a big kid listed at 6'4", 300.
That's not a guy you want to mess with.
No, he moves pretty well. And sorry, it looks like we're having a little trouble here with our microphone. So hopefully can still hear us here. But that one picked up by Preston, who's been doing such a good job on both sides of the ball. There's Bonai's coming through.
Another tough man-up there for SCAD. I don't know if they put a shot on cage in that man-up opportunity. When you're behind, you have to take advantage of those situations. That hurts.
And it's just those opportunities that we've seen SCAD let go by the wayside. I mean, they haven't been taking advantage as much as you'd like to see of their numbers. But not to take anything away from Western Oregon. Western Oregon playing very well.
No, they've got a great team. Their defense is standing tall. And I'm really impressed with their offense, particularly their attack unit so far.
Yeah, Malincek has really been a facilitator. And it's been great dodging, too. They're doing a good job of finding their dodgers. And a team that, you know, scores 350 goals in a season over the course of 16 games is going to find their goal. So this isn't a team that you want to get to shoot out with.
No, no question about it. And, you know, Malincek, he's one of the, you know, he represents one of the things I love about lacrosse. It, you know, listed at 5'6", 140 in the program. And we know that programs may even be a little generous at times. But lacrosse is not a sport for huge guys. It's not a sport for, you know, guys that are tall or guys that are this or guys that are that. If you're a great lacrosse player and a great athlete, there's a spot for you on a lacrosse field. Malincek proves that without a doubt.
And you see Dean, and there's a great pass, loses a stick, broken handle, and that one going in, and that's a huge goal again for Preston. Toss your hats, he's got 3.
Wow. You see why he's so valuable to this team. I worry over the course of a tournament if he can keep it together for 4 games. But he is a heck of a player.
But you see it's Dean with the foul. Looks like it's waved off there. It was going to be a push. But broken shaft for SCAD. And it's just enough in that unsettled situation where you're down a man to force SCAD to go into a little bit of rotation to give Preston an opportunity to score the goal there. And so it looks like they're going to need to get a guy on the far side. I think they were confused about the flag there, but waved off with the goal.
And you see now on the Western Oregon sideline, the trainer treating one of the players for what looks like a cramp. So, you know, the weather taking a toll on these guys, and they've got another long quarter to play. So
there's a great look inside with the quick stick finish coming from Samuel McDevitt on his first shot, actually listed as a goalie, the freshman.
Wow. Kids do everything, and you find guys doing that a lot in the MCLA, where they come from their high school programs as a defenseman, and the coach wants to convert him into an attackman, or you find a player who's a midfielder, and they find a spot for him with a long stick in his hand. So,
I mean, it's one of those things. I mean, you want players who want to be out on the field, and you have a kid who, you know, clearly wants to play and is willing to do whatever it takes to get on the field, and there's another big win by Preston, loses it, flips it back. That's a fantastic individual effort. I mean, you can't say enough about how well he's playing so far today. I mean, it has to be the player of the game so far. Nice look inside. What a save by Mantell on the doorstep. And hard to see what SCAD's defense is doing right now, and it looks like Malinsek may have taken one in the shin as he's still down, as McDevitt trying to get that ball up. The ball's still down, and no one's been able to pick the ball up yet. Finally picked up by Western Oregon. Malinsek still down, finally finding his way to his feet. And there's a nice wrap check and handle from Bohintz. But Malinsek gets his gloves back on and ready to play. But it's going to be a call going against Western Oregon, and definitely not what you wanted to see there.
Oh, Malinsek still still nursing whatever it is he got hurt, and he had a few choice words, it sounded like, for the officials on that play, and he's limping. He's hurt.
Yeah, I mean, that you see. It's one of those things where Dean getting a little careless with the stick there, and then the ball down. It looks like no one able to pick the ball up as it's still down with a lot of gray shirts in there as they go for the ball, and finally picked up by SCAD as he takes one in the chest, and that's Nate Travis for the Bees.
And Malinsek's going to come out and get looked at by the trainer here.
Yeah, and you can see that right across the top of his thigh. That's a pretty nasty welt that he's got. Something that, you know, I'm sure he'll probably be able to walk off, but it's going to leave a pretty good bruise.
Yep.
Brutal. And you see, looking for the cutters, moves the ball back up to Sinkowitz.
That's good to see, though. We didn't see a lot of that earlier from Savannah, a lot of those big cuts.
And there's a great pass inside. Can't come up with it. You see their players looking to goal before they get it in their stick. They've got to watch the ball into their stick. I mean, it looks like they have more time than they think they do.
Yeah, and, you know, it looks like they're trying to get all the goals back at once. They just got to take them one at a time.
Then Dugan trying to pick that one up. Gets a little too fancy, but picked up by Bohintz. And Bohintz loses the handle. I know you see the Western Oregon team dipping their sticks in water. And there's one's coming around the corner. There's a shot off the pipe. Then almost picked up by Detterman, but goes into the crease. And that's an unlucky break for Kyle Stinger, trying to get his first goal of the game.
Western Oregon keeps pushing the tempo. That's clearly their style of play.
I mean, it definitely shows, you know, the team that's they're definitely well-conditioned. Last 4 seconds here of the half. Takes a shot, buries the goal, and that's a humongous goal from McGinnis, scoring his second of the game. And that cuts the lead back to 4 with 3 seconds to go in the third quarter. And if there's any time to ever score a goal, if you're SCAD, that was the time.
Yep, they've really got to get some momentum going into this fourth quarter. They're going to have to push it. 4 is not an insurmountable lead, but they've got to do it, and they've got to tighten up on defense a little bit.
And again, just 3 seconds to go in this third quarter. 4-goal lead at 11-7 in favor of Western Oregon, and you see Preston pull that one back. And that's going to do it for the quarter, but really exciting game here on field one in Irvine. Both of these teams just trading blows. The 4-goal run at the beginning of this game by Western Oregon after going down a goal at 1-0 has been the difference in the game so far.
No question about it. And they've got a ton of talent, and they like to push the ball. I mean, they've taken 4 or 5 good shots lately, and the goaltender for SCAD's either come up with a great save or they've missed the cage. But they're not going to slow down.
And then we're getting a bunch more tweets coming in. This one coming in from Alexander Adler, player for Northern Arizona at the Division II level. You know, there's no way that number 6 on Western Oregon, Preston, is a FOGO. Kid is an all-around dynamite player. And, you know, we couldn't agree more with you, Alex. I mean, he's really been putting the team on his back.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, and not to take anything away from Stinger and a couple of those other guys, but he really means everything to this team in the midfield.
And here's another one coming in from Dane Post. Shout out to my bro, number 12, Grant Post, and the Western Oregon Lax guys watching from St. Louis, Missouri. Bring home that natty, hashtag MCLA 2014. As well as another one coming in from MJ Mitchell. Hope you're enjoying yourself in Cali, pulling for the hometown guys tonight, Michigan State Lax. And again, a whole lot of games going on today, 16 games across the Division I and Division II, over four fields in this first round of the MCLA tournament, brought to you by Encore Brand in partnership with the Lacrosse Network. So definitely excited to be able to bring you this this high-level lacrosse.
Yeah, there's great lacrosse out here. If there are people locally that want to come out and see some good games and want to see a bunch of them, this is it. And these teams are as excited to be here, you know, as any Division I, II, or III team. I heard one of the Western Oregon players during the national anthem say, you know, it's been a long time coming to get here. These players work their rear ends off all year long, and this means as much to them as anything.
Yeah, and it's they've had a fantastic season, 15-1. This is their seventh appearance in the national tournament, and you know, really successful season. And it's exciting to see these guys, you know, put something together like that with such a small squad and look really strong. Got another tweet coming in. It's SCAD's last transition goal is the way they can climb back into the game, transition game, and moving off ball, hashtag dig deeper. And that's definitely something we've been you know, echoing all game. SCAD has got to take advantage of their numbers in these unsettled situations. See Preston back out on the field to take another faceoff, taking all but one of the faceoffs so far today. I mean, he's spent nearly every minute of this game out on the field.
And he's got to get some help from his wing, or he's just going to do that every time.
Takes across, takes the shot. Mantell eats that one up, sends the ball up the field.
Preston wisely gets off the field after that one.
Yeah, and that's a tough sub, too, because now that now SCAD has numbers. But looks like Dugan able to come back and get that one.
SCAD can get one here. They're right back in it.
Yeah, again, down just four goals at 7-11. Plenty of lacrosse left to be played, especially in this fourth quarter, is when Western Oregon's really going to have to dig their heels in and leave it all out on the field. Sinkowitz. And back up top, we've seen a lot of success from the freshman, Rosala. He's able to move against the ball back. Looks like he wants to take the shot. He's got that low to high. A nice move inside. Takes the shot, and what a great finish by Sinkowitz. I mean, fantastic play from SCAD as they're really moving the ball well. And it's that off-ball movement that's giving Western Oregon some trouble.
And that's exactly what they needed.
It cuts the lead to three goals at 8-11, and SCAD with two straight goals looks to have the momentum in their corner now.
And the Western Oregon coach imploring his defenders to get there. As he says, you know, to get over there and help that guy. They cannot be lackadaisical on their slides. SCAD looks to me so far today to be primarily a one-on-one dodging team, or certainly that's how they like to initiate their offense. And if you can't get a slide to that guy, you're going to be in a little bit of trouble.
And that's a great check by the freshman, Alexander, listed as an LSM. We've seen him taking runs with both the pole and the shorty. So really impressive play out of the freshman. And that's a huge play as SCAD had the momentum and won the faceoff. And now they're going to be able to give themselves an opportunity to take some of this time off the clock and give their guys a chance to rest a little bit. And you see the pressure going down on Malinsek, as SCAD trying to keep the ball out of the hands of the senior attackman, and Malinsek losing his man gets him hung up. But just smart play out of Malinsek. Really impressed with the way that he does things out there.
He's one of my favorites on this Western Oregon team, to be sure. I really like the way he plays and how smart he plays.
There's Hawkspear trying to create some space. We saw him on the sideline earlier. And what a shot! That one on the outside of the cage. But again, Preston, you see, looks like they're trying to say that one went through a hole. And trying to figure out down there. It looks like, see what they're going to say. And they're calling it a goal. And that's four on the day for Preston. And that is a huge, huge goal. Let's see what they do on the backside of the goal here. Looks like they see a hole at SCAD. Really unhappy with that call. But the ball going through the back of the net. Let's see if they stop this play, get some zip ties. to plug that hole up. But I mean, that's a big goal, big momentum goal for Western Oregon.
I think there was that might have been an imaginary hole. I think that hole was something the SCAD players were hoping to find back there, but I don't think it's there.
Yeah.
I think that was a heck of a shot by Preston.
But I mean, you see the ball come out of the backside of the cage there. I mean, it looked like from at least from our angle that it was going to be one of those a possession shot for Western Oregon, but you see the official down there plugging the hole. Got a couple more tweets coming in. There's Friesen watching from Vancouver, Washington, home of Tyler Preston, and he's making the 360 proud today. So definitely excited that you were able to watch this game. And another one coming in from Ike. Western Oregon has to keep winning those faceoff possessions, settle, give players time to rest, and put shots on cage. And that's exactly what they're doing as Horsey comes away with the ball there. And it's the wrap checks that have been really good. I mean, Western Oregon not giving up on any of their checks. And that one kicked out and does well to keep that one in, but it goes right to SCAD player.
He's got to get that one.
And it's Mason Thurkold. Couldn't come up with it. That one went right through his legs.
But rather than hang his head, and he hustled out all the way to the midfield line almost and picked it up. So made a little mistake there, but he earned the ball back for his team. Let's see if it pays off.
No, that's one of the things you play on these play on the real grass fields. You're going to catch an unlucky bounce from time to time, and that's what there was. You had Rothstein out of the cage trying to go back and get that one as the ball was kicked back up forward by Western Oregon and then just right through the legs. But unlucky break, but SCAD maintaining possession of the ball down four goals.
And I think you make a great point, Chris. You know, that's something that well, you know, we'll see what impact it has over these next couple of days. Most of these teams play on field turf. And, you know, the days gone by where most teams play on grass, and this grass may be a little bit of an adjustment to these guys who are used to clean ground balls all the time.
Yeah, I mean, these fields are really, really nice out here in Irvine, a lot of them. But there's always little spots that'll cause trouble. And there's a big push in the back. No call, but the ball going up. Preston has it, and now they've got numbers as he's able to move it. And then Bohens open, but can't get it from Detterman, who loses his footing off of that one. And then right through the legs of the fan of the Western Oregon, but I think might have let that one through on purpose. give his boys a few extra seconds to rest. I mean, real heads-up play by the Western Oregon sideline over there.
We haven't talked about it much today, but the Western Oregon close defense has done a terrific job today, both on ball and help defense. You know, they've been quiet, nothing flashy, you know, no big checks, no big takeaways. They play good body defense, they help well, they communicate well. They're as much responsible for this lead as the offense is.
And again, a four-goal lead at 12-8. Or 9-12. Is that one coming inside? And looks like that one stays out as the official right on top of it. Rothstein does well to get that one back. Again, just a three-goal lead as Western Oregon trying to move the ball up the field. Not a whole lot of space, as it looks like SCAD doing a pretty good job of keeping the shorties covered. And there's Dugan, does well, come back and get the ball, and gets the ball across using his wheels. You see him rolling right into the double team, flips it back to Dugan, but had to get that one in the box. And Stinger using his big body at 6 foot 185 to get in the box there. Malincek now within it. Malincek by his man.
Look at those quicks.
Nice look inside. Again, the low to high flip, that one off the helmet and into the pipe. But a fantastic look from Hawkspear as he's trying to get it. And then good job on the ride. But Mate able to pick it up. And we see a player down for Western Oregon. Let's see if they let him play. Ball down. And there's a great ground ball, but loses his footing for the big guy. Coming across the center is Ryan Goh.
And I'll tell you, that's a tough call for SCAD. 34 had the ball on his stick for maybe half a second. And they called possession for him and are going to give it to Western Oregon and what was clearly still a loose ball.
And it looks like he's probably got a cramp. You see him working the calf a little bit there. But you know, I mean, that's one of those things. You can't afford to lose any guys if you're this Western Oregon squad, especially a guy who's meant as much to your offense as Hawkspear. and just a 3-goal lead as you see the trainer helping Hawkspear up off the deck.
You see that Western Oregon defense again, all together huddled around their goaltender, talking about the upcoming possession. I think that unit's really strong together. I don't think there's any one guy there that they count on to do everything, but they've got a good, solid group.
And it looks like Hawkspear might be, a little more injured than we thought there as he's walking off. Looks like he's going to be able to walk off under his own power, but an ankle or a cramp taking him off the field. But another one of the big kids from Western Oregon. Make sure to get your last couple tweets, comments, questions, anything you got coming our way as we're closing in, coming to the end of this fourth quarter here. And there's Bohintz taking it across. Bohintz loses the handle. That's a great check. And he takes one in the shin as well. Actually, it looks like he's tying his shoe. But ball coming out for SCAD as they're moving the ball up to Dean. And I like Dean on the clear here.
Yeah, he's going to have to do something for his team here. He's been working his tail off, but they need somebody to come up big right now.
And he's got to be careful not to get a ward there as he looks to be leading with his head a little bit. Now Horsey, thinking about the shot, takes it, and that one off the stick of Preston and goes right to Rothstein as Rothstein moves it up to go. Go wants to send it down the field, and again Dugan back to get the ball. But Mate out there played tough defense on him. And Dugan really showing his wheels off as he's able to cut by Dean. Nice look inside. Can't quite find his man. And the ball's going to go back to SCAD. As we see Mate looking to move the ball up the field. And he does.
We'll see here if Western Oregon understands that it may be a time to value the ball, as I've heard a coach say before. Enjoy the ball. Spend a little bit of time on possession down there. Make SCAD really work to get it back, because right now this is just an up-and-down game. And Western Oregon is not playing like a team with a 3-goal lead.
Yeah, and definitely both of these teams start to look a little tired. See Grant Post bring the ball across. Here the matchup call's coming. And we're going to get a timeout from Western Oregon. And it looks like Coach Blair really thinks his guys could use a little bit of a break, and I think he's probably right.
I think that's exactly what his team needed. Give him a chance to both rest their legs and he gets an opportunity to remind them that, hey, look, guys, we're up by a few. Continue to be aggressive, but don't force the ball and don't put yourself in a bad position where you're going to give the ball back to them.
And we haven't seen a timer on yet today in this game, which is sort of rare for a game that's this close, especially towards the end of this game. You're going to expect to see, or you'd at least like to see, if you're the sideline for Western Oregon, them take some of the time off the clock, force the officials to make that timer on call and get as much of the time off the clock as they possibly can, especially give those defensemen a little bit of a rest.
I'm not sure the way they play that Western Oregon's had a timer on the field this entire season. They like to play aggressive, and they've got the guys at attack who can do that for them. I'd like to see the ball stay down there a little bit more with 21 and 24 and see them really kind of hang on to it a bit, continue to be aggressive, but don't just give Savannah College of Art and Design easy opportunities to head down and transition.
Yeah, we got a bunch of tweets coming in across the board, all under the hashtag MCLA2014. So definitely keep those coming, as well as tweet at us here in this game at C Marshall TLN. Love to hear more about you guys at home. And Western Oregon going to bring the ball in. That's Detterman, as he's got it. Probably going to look to get the ball to Malincek. And you see SCAD really, really pressuring Malincek. And we've seen SCAD go for these, because there's a great handle inside, fighting through as he's back on the field. Hawkspear coming back. And there's a nice defensive play by Mate. Mate trying to get the ball, able to get in front of Hawkspear. Can't come up with the ground ball, but able to flip it across his body to Sinkowitz. Sinkowitz got some time, moves it across. Nice look inside, and there's a great defensive play knocking that ball down as Thurlton gets pushed and... great job getting the ball back up to Sinkowitz. Sinkowitz having a little trouble picking up the ball, and it's very dry and windy out here. Sinkowitz trying to get by his man, loses his handle, keeps the ball on his stick, but finally picked up by Hawkspear. and Hawksbeard doesn't like it as he's tapping him on the chest a little bit. Who knows what he's saying, but making it look like they're friends.
That looked like good sportsmanship to me. This game's a physical game, and you know, you'll take a hit or two that doesn't make you feel too good, and you'll want to say something about it. But you know, after the when the whistle blows, these guys are all still lacrosse players, and it's a great fraternity.
And so we're going to see is an opportunity here for SCAD to get a goal back. They've got a three goal deficit to get back, but plenty of time left in this game.
You know, SCAD did something on that last defensive possession. They really extended out. That's the first time we've seen them do that today, and it paid dividends on that last possession. If they've got the legs to do it, that may be the way they get back in this game on defense, is to continue to really press the Western Oregon offensive players who may have some tired legs.
I mean, they're really doing a good job of pressuring Malincek. And there's the shot from outside from McGinnis, and a great save by Rothstein, picked up by Dean. Dean looking back up top, Sinkowitz, and back to McGinnis. And McGinnis wants the shot again, and that one off one of the defensemen, and that feels terrible.
There's nothing worse than that.
And you can see him hobbled a little bit as Rothstein out of his cage, and there's a great body positioning play by Nate Travis, and he puts the goal in. The sophomore looking strong as they cut the lead to 2 at 10-12.
And they went right back at that spot where that Western Oregon player may have been still feeling the effects of that shot. Attack the weakness, and Rothstein thought he had to come out and make the play, and that may be the first one of what they need. They've got to win a faceoff against Preston here. They cannot allow him to go forward with the ball. I see SCAD with a pole on Preston's draw side, trying to cut him off.
And it looks like that's Hawkspear now on the faceoff. He's able to pick up the ground ball, loses the handle as the ball flipped up. Looks like SCAD's got a line on it, and that one's going to go out of bounds. Let's see who goes off of the call. Is going in SCAD's favor, and that's a really going for Western Oregon as the official pointed the other way to start, but ball going with Western Oregon, and that's a really fortunate play for the Wolves.
And you saw the SCAD attackman giving that telltale handshake. That means he took a good one across the hand on that ground ball.
There's Dugan loses the handle. Some great defense there. Looks like he's able to pick the ball up, roll away from some pressure. This comes right back into some. I like to see SCAD go for the double team there when they've got it. Get the ball down to Malincek, and this is exactly where you want the ball if you're Western Oregon.
And SCAD going to extend again. They're not going to give him a chance to settle on this ball, but they've still got to play good defense.
Malincek coming back across. Likes that roll back, trying to create some space for himself. But Western Oregon slowing the ball down a little bit. Stinger. Back up to Detterman. And you can hear the sideline. Players calling Western Oregon, letting them know that they're tired and telling them to keep pressing out. Zay loses the handle as Hawkspear able to pick it up there uncontested. They've got to continue pressuring. They're running out of time here in this fourth quarter. Got a two-goal deficit that can easily be erased if they're able to get the ball back on their side of the field. Detterman, there's no calls. You see the official signaling. Ball down, and again, looks like a little bit of tired legs. As he pushes him back, tries to get a stick on him, looking to go over the top. That's a solid check. And the ball goes out of bounds as Bohintz looking for Alexander. And again, Alexander playing with the shorty due to the small numbers, and the defenseman coming off Colin O'Neill with the Charlie horse there.
And SCAD, these last two possessions, has really extended out. It's paid off for them twice. Let's see if they can capitalize again. Good
and
check.
Henry, we've seen a lot of that. That one goes right to Horsey. But we've seen the Western Oregon players not give up and get a lot of trail checks as the SCAD players have been hanging their sticks. There's McGinnis. They're fortunate not to get a call there, a slash or a hold. As he's able to keep the ball on his stick and move the ball down, Sinkowitz.
Let's see if they can find Rosala again. He's been successful, and he's got a shorty on him now, so he may be the guy. It looks like they're going to give him a chance from X or from the wing against a shorty. So
definitely like that matchup. We haven't seen a whole lot of Natera, who's playing defense there, and he gets lost there back up top. Sinkowitz takes the shot just off the mark, but that's the look they want. And that one sneaks through. It hits the pizza truck over there. Heads up.
You got to keep your head on a swivel if you're getting a pie today.
That one coming over and then thrown over the fence, so definitely a solid play from pizza makers over there at California Peach Kitchen.
And I think I would go back. Oh.
McGinnis coming inside, draws the flag, takes the shot, but Rothstein all over that one. And it's going to be number 15. That's Griffin Castor, the junior, coming to spend some time on timeout. That's big 1 minute penalty for the slash going against Castor. It's a big opportunity here for SCAD, down just two goals to take one of those back.
And I'd like to see Rosal or Dean get the shot here. I don't even know if Dean's on the field. He's at X right now. Not where we've seen him in the past, but I'd like to see one of those guys really take the shot here.
And that one right into the stick of Rothstein. We've seen the Western Oregon players do a really good job of keeping their sticks in the passing and shooting lanes. And it's really been paying off for them as they blocked a lot of shots, and you know, forcing Rossi. And there's a great play. It looks like Malinsek has some room, opts to pull it back out, and that's a really wise move from the veteran attackman.
And the SCAD team, the SCAD bench, calling for their shutoff defense. So they're going to extend all over the field and try and get the ball away. If I were SCAD, I do not want to see the ball at X. I'd like to see these shorties handling it, but. This is the matchup here, I think, that you're looking for.
And Duguid, a guy who's got a lot of speed, go to the double team here, just about 3 minutes to go in the game. Still a two-goal lead for Western Oregon. Duguid trying to get some space here. He's a guy who likes to do it himself, take some shots. Definitely a more goal-heavy scorer.
And they've got an opportunity on the backside here.
And guess who? Preston looking for number five. Puts it in, takes the shot. Great save by Mantell. And Mate able to run that one down. The ball's going to SCAD. And Mantell standing tall when he needs to in the cage.
If SCAD gets back in this game, that may be the save we look at. One-on-one on Preston on the backside. An opportunity for Western Oregon to put this away.
And Dean can't pick it up. And that one's picked up by Hawkspear. And that's a tough break for SCAD as we're now under 3 minutes to play in the fourth quarter. There's Bohintz coming back by himself, takes the shot, scores the goal. Jump shot, what a finish. Does it all, points at the sideline, and they are fired up. That's a huge goal, pushing the lead to 3 under 3 minutes to play.
I think that's going to be a tough one for them to come back from. They make get a great opportunity there, a great save, and then they can't get that ball cleared in transition. Sure enough, they bring it right back down and put it down their throats. That Western Oregon attack is exhausted.
Yeah, we got 2 minutes, 10 seconds to go. And this might be all she wrote for the SCAD Bees. See Preston back out on the faceoff. Looks like he's got the clamp. Gets to Hawkspear. Hawkspear able to pick the ball up one-handed. And then the ball comes out. And that's great defense for McGinnis. McGinnis got some time and space. Needs to take the shot. Does. Buries it. What a finish. Low to low off the far side of Rothstein. I mean, that's just a great individual effort. I mean, knocks the ball out of Hawkspear's stick, does it all himself, beats the pole. I mean, that's a great play. And now looks like Western Oregon wants to talk it over, get his guys calmed down. Coach Blair, wanting to take a little of the air out maybe, give Preston a break before he has to go out there and take another faceoff.
This next faceoff is going to be critical. If Preston wins it, they can sit on the ball for the rest of this game. SCAD has got to get their best faceoff guy out there, and they've got to get their wings working their tails off.
Yeah, and we're just under 2 minutes to go. Still enough time for SCAD to come back and win this game. I know we saw Bryant score 3 goals in 11 seconds yesterday, so nothing is impossible, but it's certainly going to be a challenge, the way that the defense has been playing for Western Oregon. And a reminder, this broadcast, like all of the broadcasts here today on MCLA.us in partnership with Lacrosse Network, are fully interactive. So send us your tweets, comments, questions, anything you got at CMarshallTLN. Love to hear from you. We'll also be taking pictures all day at CMarshall10, at CMarshallTLN on the Instagram. So be on the lookout for a bunch of pictures from today as well. But it's been a really exciting game so far. I mean, this 8-9 matchup has definitely lived up to the seeding as both these teams going back and forth. And we got to go back to that 4-goal stretch that Western Oregon put together in the first quarter as the difference in this game.
Yeah, I think it's clear. SCAD may have, and they've got that 3-hour time difference. They came across the country yesterday, Western Oregon out here on the West Coast. You wonder if maybe they got off the bus a little slow this morning, and that may have cost them a little bit.
Yeah, and it's definitely an advantage for this smaller team in Western Oregon to have those light-colored jerseys as well. I mean, we're over 90 degrees here in Irvine today, There's no humidity, but you know, definitely playing in full pads in all black uniforms is tough.
No question about it.
And we see Preston going down on the faceoff for Western Oregon. Looks like he's got the clamp. That one won by SCAD, keeping it in the top of his stick. That's Doug Henry, throws it out of the back of the stick, and that's something we see a lot more of out of these faceoff players, as they're able to get the ball down to Sinkiewicz, and Sinkiewicz pulls it back out. Got about 90 seconds to go in this game as Horsey has it up top. Moves to Dean. Dean by his man, looking to take the shot. Does. What a save by Rothstein.
Great save.
You see him so good low, and Preston able to pick up the ground ball, flips it across, looking for the freshman, can't come up with it, takes a big hit, and that one's going to stay in bounds, at least for now, and that one goosed backwards, but picked up, and see a whistle on that one. Let's see what the call is, and it's going to stay with SCAD. You hear the sideline fired up, and Sinkiewicz going to flip it back as McGinnis, who's had a lot of luck on the dodge, working on the pole matchup here, gets to Horsey, and they're going to have to get a shot on goal here soon, closing in on a minute to play.
Yeah, they've got to go with a sense of urgency here. No time to wait.
Because they've got a two-goal deficit. They want to send this to overtime. Horsey up top, and that one just misses him. And the Indian pickup by Preston, what a play. He has got a pair on him, tell you what. I had to go for the Indian pickup there with a minute to go, and that's gutsy.
It is. Preston is the man for this team. He's earned it.
As he's calling for a sub here, as there's a flag down, and Dugan coming in, looking to take the shot, throws the fake, and that one off the pipe, but it's going to stay with Western Oregon. As they look inside, there's the shot again by Dugan, and now Mantell has it, and it looks like we're going to be 6-on-5 for the rest of this game, just about, as you see the offside going against SCAD.
You know, and although it may not matter, these Western Oregon players maybe need to take their foot off the gas a little bit. In a situation like that, with less than 2 minutes, where you've got a flag down and you've got possession, you can run that out, and should you lose the ball, you're going to get it right back. So I think a pretty easy opportunity to kill it. It may not matter in this game, but, you know, coach may want to remind them that, you know, there's a time to settle back. And you see one of the defensemen down at the far end giving Rothstein a big hug. He earned it for his team today as well.
Yeah, he had a great game. You'd almost like to see Malinsek hold on to this ball down at X and just kind of run around. I mean, he's got the kind of guys. Dugan as well has got a lot of wheels, as you see them moving the ball. Malinsek all alone downtown at X, but they're doing a pretty good job of getting that one across. That one bounces as Hawkspear loses the handle, ball still down, but using his big frame to get in front of that one, picks up the ground ball. Down to the last 10 or so seconds of this game, still man up for Western Oregon, but SCAD going to bring the ball in. They're going to have to move the ball up the field quickly and get a shot off, and that one almost picked off, but the ball's still down on the ground, and that's a decent place for it, as you see the push going against Western Oregon, and they're going to have to get a shot off here quickly. And that's going to do it for the game. The shot there at the end for Knott, and the three-goal win for Western Oregon. What a finish, and they really capped it off. And you see both these teams going to get their goalies, but Rothstein and Preston really, really did a great job for their teams today.
I think they were two of the keys, and of course Malinsek at the offensive end. I mean, you know, they're a tough team. If they can, you know, get home, rest the legs, get some water in them, I think they could challenge some other teams. They've got a good, solid defense. They've got some special players on attack. And, of course, Preston in the midfield is going to be something that other teams are going to want to figure out how to deal with.
Yeah, it's one of those things where it looked like SCAD was having some success in the unsettled situations in transition, forcing the guys to run from Western Oregon. But on a whole, Western Oregon had a plan, and they stuck to it all game, and it was able to come away with the victory here. So just a reminder, this game was brought to you by the Encore brand. And this broadcast was produced in partnership with the Lacrosse Network. Thanks for watching, and stay tuned to MCLA.us for more MCLA action coming up. And a huge thank you to Carlos Trejo for joining me on the broadcast today. It was a pleasure having you here.
Thank you, Chris. I really enjoyed it. And quickly, I'd like to thank my wife and family back home who are generous enough to allow me to come down here and enjoy a week of great lacrosse and beautiful weather while they're home up in San Jose. So thank you to my wife, Dina, and my children, Cruz and Zara.
All right, there you have it. So definitely stay tuned for some more great MCLA action coming your way. And as always, stay laxy.